I appreciate you staying for this and for the reception and for Kim's reading tonight, if you can. I understand if you have to go.
Kim has to go.
What's that?
Kim has to go.
Kim has to go, right, but she'll be here through her reading. Right? So if you can stay, that would be great. You certainly, you can stay until tomorrow morning. If you haven't worked it out with your mentor, you can meet at breakfast, you can do that too. But I want to say before we get started on this that I appreciate all of your efforts this term and also this residency. And it's been a delight working with you. I miss the people who are graduating this time, and I look forward to helping the folks graduating next time to get there, and everybody else. So, any other comments, co-director?
Yeah, one of the reasons I wanted to place this panel on the last day is so we could kind of use it interactively. Not only to comment on, you know, what we've seen, the agents, all the rest of the stuff, but so that, you know, you could turn it into a question and answer of your own. You know, if you want to talk about publishing, just talk about it. Just ask questions. You know, let's keep it as informal as possible. I, in particular, will be sort of going in circles, I think. So please don't expect a lot of cogency from me, because you probably won't get it. Who wants to go first? The longer I can wait, the better.
Well, I may actually look better coming after you.
You will look better. All right, you want me to go first?
I'll go first. I just had a couple of comments. When we got this panel together, Bill's idea was to come at it from a couple of different angles, from small press, large press, from editing in a press to sending out stuff to small presses. So I'm just going to have just a little background and then jump into some points that I have gleaned over the years as a writer and as an editor. And then we'll move on down the line, and then we'll open up to questions. And if this lasts for half an hour, that's fine, or an hour, that's fine, too. I started with my experience in publishing started with sending out short stories. Then I started my own fiction magazine, a yearly anthology called American Fiction. And I did it with Al Davis for... We have a kind of syncopation with our coffee. Because I'm going to get going too if I start laughing. For 10 years, I did American Fiction with Al Davis, and he has continued that. And there's still a yearly fiction anthology. And I'll just throw this out for those of you who want to get into the publishing area and or the writing area. I founded it as a privately published, privately financed edition of an anthology. And my goal was this. I wanted to take like the Best American Short Stories or the Pushcart Awards or the Southern or the Editor's Choice Awards or all these awards that would pick best stories from the year and usually pick 100 and then boil them down to 20. I wanted to have that kind of look to the magazine, so it looked more like a book, 300-500 page book rather than a quarterly. And the difference is we picked previously unpublished stories. And that was a kind of twist. We picked big name writers to do the judging of the last 20. And we did that for 2 years. And then my agent saw it, liked the idea, liked the concept, and sent it first to Birch Lane Press, which is a sort of medium-sized press in New York City, Carroll Publishing. And they published four. They gave us a four-book contract, two and then two. So we did 4 more years there. And then we did it for 4 or 5 more years with Al Davis through New Rivers. And then it went on a hiatus for about 4 or 5 years or more. And Al, over the last 3 or 4 years, has picked it up again. So American Fiction has continued to go. And then about, 14 years ago, I started Dogwood, the magazine you run now. And that was through and supported by Fairfield. So the first one is just initially privately funded. And I bring that up because I've been saying in my workshops about don't do self-publishing. Well, I wasn't publishing my own work. I was publishing somebody else's work, and then I'm starting my own magazine. And then once it did well and started to get a name for itself, publishers picked it up. Dogwood I did for about 8 years as the general manager, managing editor, and then fiction editor, and then passed along to Kim Richard, and Sonya's been doing it for the last 3 years. Okay, so So that gives me about 18 to 20 years of experience as an editor of literary magazines. I've read thousands and thousands of stories, probably 10 or more thousand, about 1,000 every year for at least 1,000 every year for the last, years of doing American fiction. So I gleaned a lot of stuff from that. I'll talk more about that in just a moment. As a writer, I've published about 55 stories in little magazines, three or four larger national magazines. So I had a sense from the writer's point of view, working with literary editors, what that means, what the contractual stuff is on the writer's side, also on the editor's side. I did one short story collection with a small press, University of Missouri. I'm doing one novel with a small press, Tuscany Press, that I read from the other night. So I have experience with large presses, HarperCollins, William Morrow, St. Martin's, and what that means, small presses, university presses, and then small presses for the published novels. The perspective that I would give you from that experience, both from the writer's side and from the editor's side, my work on a lit journal, a small press, helped me understand more about writing, I think, than my three or four years in grad school. reading thousands of stories really proved to me that is the best teacher. You know, reading both the good and a lot of the bad, okay? And just, we've heard people say this, by reading a lot of the bad stories, you say, geez, I did the same thing. I can't tell you the times I'd be reading a story that was good but made some major mistakes and said, I did the same thing. Also, it proved to me that if you're going to pick a subject, like Alan, I used to joke about it, we do this long distance, we call each other at night and say, how many are you reading tonight? You know, I'd read 100, or he'd read 100 or whatever. And literally, the last several years, it was 12 to 1600 that we split between us, so lots and lots of stories. So you'd see patterns emerge, and it was the story idea of the month. Yeah. Or the year or something. And we were doing it in the 80s and then early 90s, AIDS was just coming out. So you get the AIDS stories, or you get the cancer story, you get the abuse story. And so what I came up with was that a writer has to follow his or her passion. Okay? I've never written a story or written a novel that I didn't say, that's what I want to write, ever. I never listened to my editor saying, let's write a sequel, let's do this. No. I want to write what I want to write. If you look at my books, they're different, okay? Because I followed my passion. So what I would say to a writer reading lots of stories about AIDS or sexual abuse or whatever is that if that's what you want to write, then write it. Okay, that's your prerogative. Okay, that is what the writer's purview is. You know, that's your choice. You should be able to do that. But if you're going to write a story that everybody else is writing, what do you think you should tell yourself?
Do it differently.
Make it new. Make it fresh. For instance, Al and I used to laugh at night perversely at cancer stories. There'd be one cancer story after another. And I don't mean to make fun, I obviously very seriously. But they do the same old thing. And how many did you get? I got three. How are they dying here? How are they dying? What kind of lymphoma do they have here? And so, and I know that sounds coarse and crass, but as an editor, you got to keep your sanity. And then every once in a while, we get a story that just came out of the left field in terms of writing something old but making it new. Mm-hmm. Okay. And I remember we published a story in Dogwood some time ago that was I think it was Dogwood, and it was about a woman who was dying. And she didn't want to go to a funeral home and have a funeral person do the stuff with her, okay? You know, take the blood out and do all that stuff. She wanted a husband to do that, because that's who she trusted. And so he jumped in and started learning how to do, using formaldehyde and all this stuff. And that's what I said, wow.
Holy crap.
Holy crap. And it was a new story. It was a brand new story. It was the old story, but retold in a new kind of fashion. So if you're going to tell the old story, that's one of the things I learned from reading these thousands of stories. Tell it new. Make it new. Make it fresh. You can tell your story, because that's what you're burning to tell, but you got to make it new. Okay? I mean, the whole notion that they said there's 37 different plots, supposedly somebody sat down and did that. So you're not going to tell a new story. There's nothing new under the sun. It's the way you tell it. okay? The way the voice is going to be new, the angle that you take, and so on and so forth. Okay, by, as I said, you'll learn the good and the bad. Two, you'll make contacts. And contacts are very important. Don't let anybody tell you they're not. If you work as an editor or an agent and you're a writer too, you're going to make a lot of great contacts. If you work as an editor for a literary magazine and you're accepting stories, and when you send your stories or poems or essays out, okay, and you send it out in the letterhead of your magazine like Mason's Road, they're going to take a look, a closer look at your work. Okay? Now, I know that the ethics of that are questionable, but that's the reality of it. That is the reality of it, okay?
When did that ever stop us before?
Okay, I know. Okay. All right, and I think that's another good reason to get involved either in a magazine or a literary magazine, Mason's Road or Dogwood or, you know, one of the editing things that we have here. And it's a good way to make contacts, connections. So learning your craft, making connections. When I used to send my stuff out as a short story writer before I became a novelist, before I wrote a novel, I saw a really interesting article by Richard Ford, and he had a pyramid. He said, I wanted to climb that pyramid, and the bottom of the pyramid were small magazines, and the middle of the pyramid were better magazines, and the very top of the pyramid were the very best magazines. In that time, it would have been the New Yorker, the Atlantic, Harper's, Esquire, and then the very, very good Paris Review, those kinds of magazines. And he felt that he would climb that ladder as a story, and I would say that's poetry, I would say that's short fiction, essays, articles, climb that ladder. He didn't succeed in doing that. He was able to write a novel and he was able to jump up to the top of the pyramid, okay, according to him. And I love Richard Ford as a writer. So I think as a writer, you need to know what the marketplace is out there, okay? And I think this program should give you that and should give you the curiosity to find out about that marketplace. The marketplace has changed, okay? When I was doing it in the 60s and 70s, sending out stories, you know, there were about 10 or 12 big marketplaces that you could submit stories to. Even airline magazines had stories in there. America, I had a story in American Way, American Airlines. That's virtually not out there anymore for us. You know, the New Yorker publishes occasionally. The Atlantic used to be the best publisher of fiction once a month. They don't publish regularly. You know, they publish sometimes summer fiction. So that market is not out there for you. So where do you go? There's plenty of other great literary magazines. Who was the woman here for the literary magazines the other day for the panel?
Kathy,
okay. She talked about that, okay. And the three books you need to get your hands on would be the International Directory of Little Magazines and Small Presses. We've talked about that in our workshop. I'll say that again, International Directory of Little Magazines and Small Presses. And that comes out every 2 years. I get the latest edition because magazines typically go out of business very quickly. And Poets and Writers, I just subscribe to that, or the AWP, the Writer's Chronicle. Yeah. Okay, and there's also a Fiction Writers Marketplace. You can get that as well. But you get that, and you have a better sense of what's out there. And also, I would never suggest that you write for the market. You know, except maybe in a nonfiction topical book, a book that's, you know, hot right now, or an idea that's hot right now, or an essay that you, but for fiction and poetry and not creative nonfiction, I would suggest that you write what you want to write, something that moves you, touches you in some kind of way, and then try to find the market. But you should know what's out there, where you can send these things. Huffington Post has, you know, you've published in Huffington Post, right? I mean, there's lots of places like that that are really prestigious, that may not be a print journal, but they're really good. I'd also look for contests and theme issues of different magazines. You can find that in Poets and Writers and the AWP Writers Chronicle. What do I mean by that? Let's just say you wrote a story about a horse, and it's a really good story about a horse, either creative nonfiction or fiction, and you look, and lo and behold, there's a contest that says, we're looking for stories about horses, okay? That you'd have, suddenly you jump way up in terms of your possibility of getting accepted there. So there's thematic issues, I'm sure you've seen that. Simultaneous submissions, the writers on the panel may disagree, I strongly suggest that you do, okay? And I can talk more about that later in our Q&A, but I strongly suggest that you do have and do employ simultaneous submissions. I'll qualify that a little bit later, but let me just say that. I don't send your work before it's ready. Don't send your work before it's ready. How do you know it's ready? Your mentor could say, this is a great poem. This poem is ready to go out. This essay is superb. Get it out. Or a story or a chapter from a novel. Also, do send when it's ready. Okay? Don't let it sit in your desk or on your computer, just sitting there collecting dust. Okay? I have a lot of other things I can talk about. I think that's it for now.
I'll follow up on some of what Michael was talking about. I'm the managing editor of Dogwood. I had worked for quite a few years as a reporter and a journalist, and started my first creative publication was I found a call for anthologies that was in the classified ads at the back of Poets and Writers magazine. So those classifieds are a great source for, you know, specific interest anthologies and journals and contests that might be smaller, so they're really great as places to break in. So I would second what Michael said about looking at poets and writers. I want to talk about just a few things specific to publishing online. I think that even 6 or 7 years ago, my advice to writers about publishing online would be very different than what it is now. So I would have said, publish online sparingly, right? Or there's no way that an online publication is going to have the same prestige as an print. But that has definitely changed. So now there's a top tier of literary journals that are either publishing only online or they have an online exclusive as a supplement to their print publication, right? But the fantastic thing that we have now that we didn't have, say, a decade ago, obviously, is this complete wealth of information about literary journals online. So if you're not sure at all about places to publish, there is no substitute for the time that it will take to just slip your toes into the world of literary journals online. And a good place to start is someplace like New Pages. So just Google newpages.com, and that is sort of an overwhelming list of literary journals, A to Z, and also a separate listing of small and independent publishers. And really, there is no substitute for just randomly diving in, clicking on a link of a journal that seems interesting, and then you slowly get to find what you like. And finding of all the hundreds and literally hundreds of online journals, you start to educate yourself and start to get a sense of what the most prestigious are, right? So you can start randomly. Another good way to start to realize what the ecosystem of literary journals is to go to a big place, like say the Paris Review, and click on the links of other literary journals that they consider to be in there, you know, like themselves, right? And you'll gradually get a sense of what names become familiar as you click around. But you have to read some of these journals just to get a sense of what you like. And you should submit to journals that are publishing stuff that you actually enjoy reading. Like, that might sound too simple, but that's how you know what place is right for you. So find the stuff that you like before anything else.
Can I interrupt for 1 second?
Yeah, sure.
My agent, I've told my group that my agent, I've had the same agent for 33 years. He found me because he read about 75 or 100, he subscribed to 75 to 100
right.
literary journals.
Wow.
And that's where he found my story, sent to me and says, are you agented?
Right.
I said, no, and that's been 30 years, something years ago.
That's great. That's wonderful. So, right, so a huge benefit to publishing both online and in print is that it gets your work out there, and then hopefully someone will find you who wants to help you along in your career. So the question, I would think, the number one question facing a writer is, if you're going to publish your work, and what are the benefits of publishing in print versus online, right? As I said, the prestige is different now than it used to be. I actually tend to like publishing online, and I have my pyramid. I think every writer sort of has the pyramids of the places they've published and then where they want to go next. But for me, it's actually, right now, it's pretty gratifying to be able to publish something, publish nonfiction, and then immediately connect with writers and just other readers, right? So for me, that actually is a benefit. I used to be aiming solely for print publications, but now I'm really looking for a mix. And then two last things I want to talk about briefly is sort of the role of social media for writers, because there's this big thing that I've heard about and a lot of worry for writers about, like, I hear you can't get published if you don't have a platform, right? Or if you don't have 2,000 Twitter followers, no publisher is going to touch you. And as far as I've heard, there's no clear formula, right? And I've heard some writers, you know, go so far as to say that really, if you're working on every minute you spend building your platform is time that you're not spending writing, right? So it really can be a sort of a sinkhole of energy that doesn't go where it's supposed to go now at this stage of your careers. On the other hand, I mean, I think that spending a conservative amount of time, at least having a Twitter account, having other social media, it can be a good investment in that it allows you to send out information about where you're published when you get published. And having those contacts, as Michael said, in the real world and also online really helps. So for example, I have a number of social media contacts that started out that way, where conversations have developed that led to invitations for readings, that led to invitations for appearance at conferences and panel proposals. So the social media environment among writers is pretty rich online. So, I mean, I think rather than seeing it as, again, that you have to friend everyone and that your platform has to be bigger than anyone else, you should really find authors whose work already inspires you, who are giving information out there that you actually, that's helpful to you. Just, you know, nurture that section of your contacts, and that will, you know, that'll end up paying itself back to you. And then finally, I think social media is really good as a way to send fan mail to your writers, and that has actually been really critical for my own career. Just sending a friendly note to maybe Twitter stalk somebody whose work you love, like, it's been surprising to me how often that has actually ended up helping me. And then the last thing I want to say is the issue of blogging for writers. I think that's also, that can be dicey because, say you've got a story that everyone's rejected or 10 people have rejected, and you have a blog, and it can be really tempting to say, well, I'll just put it on the blog, then it's published. And I would say that an online presence of some form, like a blog, is helpful, right? But it, again, does not have to take a ton of your time. Having an online presence, a way for people to find you, is great. For me, the way that I do a blog is I strictly limit it to a place for people to contact me, links to my published work, which is helpful for people who want to follow you, and then bits and pieces of stuff that I'm not even going to bother trying to submit anywhere, you know, just sort of like the half-assed notions. So I would really, I think there's a hope for some writers that blogging can develop into like a full-scale means of supporting yourself. And I think that that is a whole separate career that I don't know if any of us are able to really advise people on. But monetizing a blog and blogging full-time, I think, is different than the career of a literary writer. So, I mean, I've heard from people that a blog can reach up and really consume you. So I would actually urge you to have a presence, but not to put too much of your work online, because if it's published these days on a blog, most literary outlets won't take something that's already appeared on your blog. So don't publish too much there. So those are just some thoughts.
I don't even know what a Twitter stalk is. What is it? What's a Twitter stalk?
Twitter stalking? It's like when you just find someone on Twitter and you send them a Twitter message. Oh. I know, Cliff's the same way. He's like, I don't know how to Twitter.
Twitter stalking? Twitter. Sounds wrong to me.
That's why he's even got this written here, Twitter stalk.
I couldn't believe it. Did I spell it right? I think so. Well, what would a panel be without a handout? You know? Gotta have handouts. And I think, luckily, some people have gone home, so I think I might have enough.
You got the characters. You get them too.
Awesome.
This is going to be, because of my condition, it's going to be kind of a collage presentation, which means it's going to be associative, bounce all over the place. I've been thinking about this for 2 or 3 months, and I've come at it from about 5 different angles. And self-publishing is my bailiwick today. And the first thing you can see on here is famous self-published books. And you'll probably be shocked by a couple of these, right? Ulysses, Leaves of Grass, they're right up there in shotgun, right? Time to Kill, Huckleberry Finn, The Commitments by Ronnie Doyle, who would have thought of that, right? 50 Shades of Grey, that doesn't surprise me at all. But, you know, that's kind of exactly what I'm going to talk about. The self-publishing world is just totally a whacked out world. Talking about Twitter stuff. Self-publishing world is crazy. And it's changed remarkably. In a minute I want to read collaboratively with you the second piece in here about Still Alice, which is Lisa Genova's story, which is pretty interesting. It ended up being made into a movie. But there are plenty of changes in the self-publishing world. 20 years ago, it was totally different than it was 10 years ago. And now, everybody is doing it. You know, editors at Random House, one who was here with us, regularly trolls Smashwords and other self-publishing sites to try to see which ones are doing well so we can acquire them. You know, the publishing world is in a huge sea change. And everything is true all at once. Everything that Michael said and Sonya said is true in terms of magazines, in terms of presses and traditional publishing. That's all there. And if you want that route, there's nothing wrong with that route, you know, somebody else is in control. Self-publishing, you're in control of the whole thing, for the most part, until things change. Let's take a look at the second thing here, Lisa Genova's story. I'm going to read the first paragraph, but I'm going to have you guys have to do it. I'm going to go to Emily and Jennifer and Andrew, and you guys do a paragraph after I do. It's called Books Unbound. It's the second one in here. Lev Grossman from Time from about 6 years ago. Here's a literary parable for the 21st century. Lisa Genova, 38, was a healthcare industry consultant in Belmont, Massachusetts, who wanted to be a novelist. But she couldn't get a book published for love or money. She had a PhD in neuroscience from Harvard, but she couldn't get an agent. I did what you're supposed to do, she says. I queried literary agents. I went to writers' conferences and tried to network. I emailed editors. Nobody wanted it. So Genova paid $450 to a company called iUniverse and published her book, Still Alice, herself.
That was in 2007. By 2008, people were reading Still Alice. Not a lot of people, but a few, and those few were liking it. Genova wound up getting an agent after all, and an offer from Simon & Schuster of just over $500,000. Borders and Target chose it for their book clubs. Barnes & Noble made it a Discover pick. On January 25th, Still Alice will make its debut on the New York Times bestseller list at number 5. So this is extreme to extreme, right? Genova says. This time last year, I was selling the book out of the trunk of my car.
Something has changed, and it's not just the contents of Lisa Genova's trunk. We think of the novel as a transcendent, timeless thing, but it was shaped by the forces of money and technology, just as much as by creative genius. Passing over a few classical and far eastern entries, the novel in its modern form really got rolling only in the early 18th century. This wasn't an accident, and it didn't happen because a bunch of writers like Defoe and Richardson and Fielding suddenly decided we should be reading long books about imaginary people. It happened as a result of an unprecedented configuration of financial and technological circumstances. New industrial printing techniques meant you could print lots of books cheaply. A modern capitalist marketplace had evolved in which you could sell them. And for the first time, there was a large, increasingly literate, relatively well-off urban middle class to buy and read them. Once those conditions were in place, writers like Defoe and Richardson showed up to take advantage of them.
Fast forward to the early 21st century, the publishing industry is in distress. Publishing houses, among them Simon & Schuster, Macmillan, HarperCollins, Doubleday, Houghton Mifflin, Harcourt, are laying off staff left and right. Random House is in the midst of a drastic reorganization. Salaries are frozen across the industry. Whispers of bankruptcy are fluttering around borders. Barnes & Noble just cut 100 jobs at its headquarters, a measure unprecedented in the company's history. Publishers Weekly predicts that 2009 will be the worst year for publishing in decades.
A lot of headlines and blogs to the contrary, publishing isn't dying, but it is evolving and so radically that we may hardly recognize it when it's done. Literature interprets the world, but it's also shaped by that world, and we're living through one of the greatest economic and technological transformations since the early 18th century. The problem won't stay the same. It has always been exquisitely sensitive to newness, hence the name. It's about to renew itself again into something cheaper, wilder, trashier, more democratic, and more literacy fertile than ever.
Yeah.
What's the matter with publishing? It isn't the audience. People are still reading. According to a National Endowment for the Arts study released on January 12th, literary reading by adults has actually increased 25% since 2002, the first such increase in 26 years. So that's not the problem. What is?
The economy, obviously. Plenty of businesses are hurting, and it doesn't help when new media, like video games, sales up 90% in 2008, are now competing with books for our entertainment hours and dollars. But publishing has deeper, more systemic problems, like the fact that its business model evolved during an earlier fiscal era. It's an antique, a financial cult camp that dates back to the Depression.
Mary?
Consider the exam system, whereby a publisher pays an author a non-returnable upfront fee for a book. If the book doesn't earn out in the industry parlance, the publisher simply eats the cost. Another example, publishers sell books to stores on a consignment system, which means the stores can return unsold books to publishers for a full refund. Publishers suck up the shipping costs both ways, plus the expense of printing and then pulping the merchandise. They print way more than they know they can sell to kind of create a buzz, and then they end up taking half of those books back, says Sarah Nelson, editor-in-chief of PW. These systems were created to shift risk away from authors and bookstores and onto publishers. But risk is something the publishing industry is less and less able to bear.
If you think about it, shipping physical books back and forth across the country is starting to seem pretty 20th century. Novels and novelists shrugging off their expensive papery cuts and transmigrating digitally into other forms. Devices like the Sony Reader and Amazon's Kindle have gained devoted followings. Google has scanned more than 7 million books into its online database. The plan is to scan them all, every single one, within 10 years. Writers podcast their books and post them chapter by chapter on blogs. Four of the five best-selling novels in Japan in 2007 belong to an entirely new literary form called Keitai Shoseki, novels written and read on cell phones. Compared to the time it costs to replicate a digital file and shipping it around the world, that is zero and nothing. Printing books on paper feels a little paleolithic.
Hey, Elizabeth, will you jump to the next page? The vanity of vanities, all is vanity.
Okay. All right. Geneva had reached the end, Decker. Am I in the right?
Yeah, when Geneva had reached the end.
When Geneva had reached the end of her unsuccessful search, she told the last literary agent who rejected her, "I've had enough of this. I'm going to go self-publish it." That was by email, she says. He picked up the phone and called me within 5 minutes and said, "Don't do that. You will kill your writing career before it starts."
It's true. Saying you were a self-published author used to be like saying you were a self-taught brain surgeon. Over the past 5 years, vanity publishing has become practically respectable. As the technical challenges have decreased, You can turn a Word document on your hard drive into a self-published novel on Amazon's Kindle store in about 5 minutes. So has the stigma. Giga-selling fantasist Christopher Fellini started as a self-published author. After Brunonia Barry self-published her novel, The Lace Reader, in 2007, William Morrow picked it up and gave her a two-book deal worth $2 million. The fact that William P. Young's The Giga was initially self-published hasn't stopped it from spending 34 weeks on the New York Times bestseller list.
Okay, good. That's enough. I think you get the point, right? Sea change, lots of new stuff. I published 4 books before I published Saving Troy. I published 3 books since. I self-published Saving Troy in the first edition. And the reason was I wanted to be in control of how it looked. My publisher, which was BOA, very prestigious poetry press, great press, Steve Huff, who was my editor there, said, you know, I'll publish the book. We don't do prose, but we'll start a prose line and I'll publish the book. And I said, but how are you going to market the book? And he said, well, you know, we'll do the same thing we've always done. We'll print 1,000 copies and, you know, it'll go to our distributor consortium. And, you know, and I said, yeah, it'll sit in the warehouse because you don't spend any money advertising. And he said, well, yeah, we don't have the money to spend on advertising. So I said, that's not going to work for me. So I had an agent, Don Condon, who was a great agent. He was a William Sirens agent, a Bradbury's agent. He liked the proposal. He sent it around. And he sent it probably, he did a great job. He sent it to 18 or 19 presses, editors. And they all said exactly the same thing, which is, we love the writing in this book. What's with Troy, New York? Who cares? If he'll set it in Miami or New York City or LA, we'll buy it. And I said, it's about Troy. I can't just send it in LA, you know? Sorry, you know? It's a nonfiction book. So, you know, I talked to Grey Wolf and a couple of other people, and, you know, a bunch of people made noises about publishing it, but I finally said, you know, screw this. My friend Gene Mirabelli had run a press called Spring Harbor for years, and he said, Bill, just start your own press. This was 2004. And so, you know, I asked a friend of mine to loan me $10,000, and he paid for the lawyer to set up the LLC, and I started a press called Hudson Whitman. And I found a publisher in China, and they would do exactly what I wanted them to do. I wanted to put photographs in the front and in the back, which I did, like Walker Evans and James Agee's Let Us Now Praise Famous Men. It's the only other book I know that has photographs in the front and in the back, and I always loved that model. I said, I want to do that. Well, the minute you say to a regular publisher, oh, by the way, there'll be 48 black and white photographs, front and back, it's like, yeah, right, we're not doing that. Publishers don't smythe sew. You know what smythe sew means? You take the signatures, it's like when you open a book like this, right? How many times has the book cracked on you? And then boom, the pages start to fall out, right? That's because it's glued. Well, smize sewing is they take the signatures and they sew each one. Well, the press in China, in Beijing, would do that, right? So I ordered 3,000 copies, which was insane. And it was like $350 each. So it was like $10,500. And that didn't include all the other stuff. The lawyer for the LLC, the book designer, the cover designer, there's lots and lots of costs in doing this. I was probably $20,000 into it, right? And this was November of 2004, and I had no idea how I was going to sell it. I just got, I kind of got interested and curious about starting a press. I thought, that'd be fun, right? I'll publish a book, you know? Let's do it. So I did it. And a guy who had been on the book, a guy named Phil Bailey, had been a reporter, a TV news reporter, and I ran into him at a dinner. And I said, hey, Phil, you know, I'm just publishing a book and you're in it. And he said, get out of here. Send me a copy. Next thing I know, he goes on his TV news show, which is at 6 a.m., and he holds a book up and he says, I'm in a book. Right? Now, I haven't done anything with a book. I have a cellar full of boxes. I have 150 boxes of 20 books each. All right? And my wife is saying, this was a great idea. The whole cellar is full of these books. What are you going to do with them? All of a sudden, the phone starts ringing. Bookstores, newspapers, TV stations are like, hey, what's that book Phil Bailey's in? And pretty soon, like, it was flying out the door. Flying out the door, right? We sold 5,000 hardcover copies in 3 months. Which was incredible. We sold the first 3,000 in the first month, and so I ordered another 3,000 thinking, wow, we have a hit. I'm going to keep going, right? Oh, that was a big mistake. So in any case, here's a perfect little anecdote from this, which will, I think, segue me into what I want to really say about self-publishing. It's no longer about who will validate me. It's no longer about should I be embarrassed because I've self-published this book. I mean, this book, I ended up selling to SUNY Press. They bought the paperback edition. They bought the 1,700 copies I hadn't sold. They tore the covers off, they put new covers on, and they're still selling, still in print. So, you know, I mean, the book even can have another life, even if Random House doesn't pick it up. You know, a university press will pick it up. So, Susan Novotny runs a place called the Bookhouse in Albany, which is a terrific independent bookstore, and she's very savvy. She was head of the Independent Bookstore Owners Association, a national organization. So she called me up and she said, Bill, you know, we're selling a lot of your books, you know, come and do a signing. So I show up to do the signing. It was Christmas. It was about 2 weeks before Christmas. And I pull up, and I'm not thinking anything. You know, I've got like three boxes of books in the back, you know, and I think, well, yeah, okay, we're going to sell some books. Boom, 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 boom. So I pull up, and I look at the front of the store, and she's got like these two big windows, and the windows are full of my book. There's no other book. This is my book. There must have been 200 copies of the book in the window on like these vertical and horizontal racks. And I had this out-of-the-body experience. I was looking at it like, holy crap, that's my book. And it's filling both windows. And so for a minute, I felt that elation. You feel like, wow, this was my dream, right? And then I thought, really? That was my dream? My dream was to have 200 books in the bookhouse window? You got to come up with a better dream. It's like, really, that's not a good dream. Right? So then I went in, you know, it was a great signing. We sold 105 books. People were like out the door for hours. It was great. And she sold, I think, 900 copies of the book at that location and 800 at her Troy location. So 1,700 of the 5,000 books I sold were sold by two bookstores, which is pretty amazing. Right? So the question for you is, why are you publishing? What's it about? Are you looking for a validation? It's time for a reality check, I think. And because everything has changed so radically in the last 10 years around self-publishing, you can make the decision about whether you want to be in control of your work or not. You don't have to get Random House or Simon Schuster or HarperCollins or all the terrific traditional publishers to support you. You know, for one thing, you got to go through that whole editorial process. You got to have an agent, because editors aren't going to read them unless they're agent. The agent's got to accept you, the editor's got to accept you, the editor's got to get it through an editorial meeting with the other editors to sell it. You know this process. Your books have done this all the time. It's very hard to get one of those big presses, traditional presses, to take your work and get behind it. My friend Marion Nord Smith, who's a memoirist, wrote a book with Michael Baden. Remember Michael Baden? HBO's Autopsy?
Yeah.
He was the guy, he was O.J. Simpson, the guy who did the O.J. Simpson case. He was very famous. Marion did a book with Michael about, it was called The Dead Book. And it was all about forensic medicine, and it came out in September
10th,
2001.
Oh, wow.
And Simon & Schuster, which had published 100,000 hardcover copies, canceled the whole thing.
Oh.
She had a 15-city book tour, and it was like, canceled the whole thing. So, you know, there's no guarantee, even if you get, you know, what you think is going to be your dream, there's no guarantee. So my reality check for you is, I even have a form for this, of course. I'm sure I can find it, I'll read to you. Where is it? Yeah. No matter what you're going to do, I think you've got to establish your purpose. Right? Why are you writing what you're writing? You know, ask yourself that question. You know, here you're writing it because you have to have a thesis to complete the MFA. We've got that. But past that, you know, when you graduate and you take that thesis and you say, wow, this is great. It's much better than when I started. I want to write a book from this. Why are you writing that book? And what do you hope is going to happen with it? And I think you should be aware of the practical considerations of it. The emotional reasons, philosophical, spiritual goals, I think that's all really essential stuff to think about. And do you want to spend 2 or 3 years or longer finding an agent, having an agent send it around, basically weathering all the stuff that happens, or do you want to self-publish that book? And I don't mean with Ex Libris or I Universe or the vanity presses. Those vanity presses are still out there and they're crap. They do omnibus ads in the New York Times once every few weeks and it's embarrassing. You know, you don't want to do that. What you want to do is be in control of your own work. And there are plenty of ways to do that and maintain quality. Secondly, who's your audience? Who are you writing for? Can you reach that audience on your own? Do you need a large publisher to distribute that book? And, you know, I don't know if you've talked to bookstore owners recently. You know what they order? Like two or three books. The end of the anecdote about Susan Novotny is I had to go back to her store the day after Christmas that year to pick up some books. There was no book in the window. There was no book on the front table. There was no book anywhere in the store except in the regional section. There was one copy which was turned the wrong direction. Mm-hmm. Bookstore owners are not loyal to you. They don't care. It's just product. So, you know, once you realize that, you know, so Simon & Schuster publishes your book, and they send it two copies to every bookstore in the country. And 6 months later, when they don't sell those two copies, go back. And, you know, I mean, unfortunately, there aren't that many books that do that well. So, who's your audience? If you're a primary reader, editor, agent, teacher, thesis advisor, friend, enemy, whatever. Secondary readers, who else might see the piece of writing other than the person for whom it's intended? What are the unforeseen possibilities? And what's the total disaster that's going to happen if nothing works? Mm-hmm. And, you know, here you're all about getting the book done. So here it's all about method. But when you finally get to the part where you say, how do I get this out to readers? Because frankly, that's the point, right? You want people to read what you wrote. You want to be able to communicate your ideas and your meanings to people. So how do you do that? Clearly I haven't done a lot of self-publishing. I did one book and I didn't go back to it. You know, 7 of the 8 books have been published by other presses. But I still think it's really important to do something that gives you control of your work. So I guess what I'm saying is don't just write off self-publishing because you think it's vanity stuff. It's not necessarily.
Can I give the flip side of that?
Sure.
Okay, and I think Bill is exactly right to suggest that certain books, because of their market, their niche, their whatever, are may be perfect for self-publishing. I think Troy is a perfect example of that. It's specific to a city, and there's going to obviously be a lot of interest, and a lot of major publishers are not going to be interested, as you said.
It's a regional book.
Regional book, and I think that makes sense. And I think the list here is also revealing, but it's also, if you give a list of successful self-published books here, I could give you a catalog, okay, of the ones that weren't so successful, and there's 3,000 books in somebody's basement. And I also rebuild that.
That's the norm, I think.
That's the norm, mm-hmm. And you should know that.
That is the norm.
And also, self-publishing is changing and is becoming more, just like online, I thought that was a very good point that Sonya said, but just like online is becoming more, not the norm, but more accepted. And I think that's important, too. We had an agent come here about a year ago, and he was the agent for John Clinch, who wrote Finn. Huck Finn, there's a story about Huck Finn's father. He got all sorts of great reviews. He came out with another more regional novel, and then his third novel, The Thief of Auschwitz, he decided to avoid that and wanted to have control. And Thief of Auschwitz was self-published, okay? The book was not a nice copy like that. It was printed in paperback, and it's not a nice copy. I bought the book up in Vermont. Pages are falling out. Didn't have any quotes on the back, didn't have any blurbs, mm-hmm. Nothing from the New York Times. The problem with self-publishing is the problem with the other things that go along with publishing it in a, whether it be a big house or a medium-sized house or a small house, is that you have an editor there, okay, and that's important. So many self-published books are sloppy, lousy, because they don't have an editor, or two or three editors, you know, a major editor, you know, the acquisitions editor who may ask you to make some major changes, the line editor, and then somebody who's doing, you know, copy editing and proofreading and fact-checking. You don't have that. And most people can't afford either the time or the effort to pay somebody to do that. But you need that, too, to make an average book or a good book into a really good book or a great book. Okay? And then reviews and distribution and promotion, that's your stuff. Okay, that's going to fall back on you. Your self-publishing places, that's your thing. Now, control is important, but it's, you know, a novel, let's say, or a book is a collaborative work between editor and writer. And I've had some bad editors that I disagree with and butt heads with, and I've had a lot of good editors, including my agent, who's helped me a lot on all of my books, who's helped me get the book in shape to send it out to either a big press or a small press. And part of the question you should have, and Bill frames the question very, very thoughtfully and correctly, I think, that, you know, what kind of book are you writing? If you're writing a highly literary novel with experimental stuff, well, you know, maybe you shouldn't be sending to one of the big, you know, general purpose, general presses, you know. But before you send to self-publishing or go that route, and it's always the option, you could say, what if I go to a really good, I mean, I had a great experience with Mark Mann, published by University of Missouri Press. They were careful editors, they were supportive, they sent my book out everywhere, you know, just like big press. And I've had 6 books that published by big presses that, you know, sometimes, you know, Soul Catcher, they did everything. But in the other ones, I had to do a lot of legwork, and I knew that. And I would say whether you do it self-publishing or big press or somewhere in between, you have to do a lot of the legwork. Mm-hmm. And that means promotion, getting on the phone, emailing, sending letters out, doing all that stuff, contacting people. I mean,
it's a huge amount of work. I took a year off to do it, from start to finish.
Just a quick story, a brother's blood. My agents, I talked a little bit about this. I know I talked to in my group, but I don't think I shared this with the group. My agent thought it was ready, and he put it out there for an auction, and no one took it. There were a couple very close, and no one took it. But one place really wanted me to revise it. I did. It later went to Random House. And my editor left Random House after about a year and went to HarperCollins. And the book sat in limbo for about 3 years. Mm-hmm. 3 years, unpublished, 3 years. I threatened to sue, finally, and it scared them, and they were going to print it. And they're going to print 4,200 copies, back in the old days before there was print on demand. 4,200, a little hardback number. And they were going to say, 4,200, get off our back, we printed your book, publish your book, now go away. And I took up the mantle, and I spent 2 hours a day for about a year calling people. And this is before the widespread use of email, sending it out to everywhere, buying copies, sending them out my own copies, my own gas, my own everything, and it went through one edition, a second edition, it went through 8 editions in hardback. And then it won awards and went through 3 editions in paperback. And then they wanted me for a second and a third and a fourth book. But you had to do all that stuff, okay? I can't imagine what it would be like to do it if you were self-publishing, you know? One of the things that a big or a medium size, and all of the American fictions editions were not big presses, they were medium-sized presses in New York City. Or small presses, they can get behind it, okay? And they can do things. Now, you also have to do things, okay? But what a big, medium, or small press can do is the editor and all of that, the various editors, okay, the promotion, the reviews, the distribution, you know. And I think, you know, Bill makes a good point that sometimes self-publishing may be the way to go, either based on the project you're working on or the type of book or whatever. But I would, my argument would be try the other ones first before you go that route. So.
Well, also, don't get me wrong. I'm not admonishing you to go out there and self-publish. Because we're trying to give you a spectrum of possibilities here, I happen to get the self-publishing part of this. So. My rhetorical argument is, hey, that's not as bad as you think it might be. Right?
And the 2 editions of American Fiction, I self-published before I sold the next 4. Right?
Yeah.
So I did that too.
So it's just, you know, all of these things are possibilities, and just consider them all. That's all. They're all options.
Question. What about things that don't tend to be read by the general public a lot, like poetry, said, right? After I write a successful novel.
So. Well, poetry presses know that, you know, and so
just go to poetry.
Well, I mean, you know, you're naturally going to be sending to poetry magazines and poetry presses anyway, but, you know, mm-hmm. the good poetry presses, you know, Steve Huff's Tiger Bark Press and BOA and Copper Canyon, you know, there are plenty of, University of Pittsburgh, plenty of great poetry presses. They, for the most part, I think they still publish quality work. They know they're not going to sell a lot of them, so they're looking to be prestigious. They're looking to publish, you know, really good books and poems. And I think, you know, do you agree with that?
I agree with that completely. I mean, if you look, and that's why it's good to do your research while you're writing, after you finish writing. I strongly suggest that for the most part, unless you have a very topical kind of either essay or nonfiction book, you don't write for market. You write the best poetry, short stories, novel, and then try to find, and then work on it. But like poetry, there are hundreds of really good journals, and there are dozens of really good poetry presses that publish good quality, both the quality of the material, quality of the writers, and they have good editors that will work with you. There's plenty of them.
And there's also, so both for poetry, fiction, and nonfiction on the literary side, a lot of these small and medium-sized publishers will run annual contests. So that's the way, especially poets will, you know, it's the entry fees can be a little bit steep, but it's a good investment to try it and dip your toe in the water that way.
You know, the thing the other day with the agents that I found really disappointing, especially with Mark Gottlieb, is that he just wrote off whole sections of literature. He wrote off poetry, he wrote off short stories.
Yeah. Really?
Oh, yeah.
Now, Sam should write a novel first.
Yeah, because in his terms... Because in his terms, they aren't commercial.
Well,
right?
look where he's coming from. He's an agent in a big agency. And agents are only going to do nonfiction, memoir, and novels. Because they're going to sell a significant... And once you get an agent in, you have to have a certain amount of, you know, 10,000, 20, 50, 100,000, okay? Poetry doesn't do that. Short stories don't do that. You know, collections of essays, with some exception. And I know we said there are some notable exceptions for short stories, but for the most part, you know, that you know, 99% of the short story collections, even no matter how good they are not going to be handled by major presses. You're going to, you know, now if you make a name for yourself, Joan Bel-Harry or Louise Erdrich, and there are other examples like that, have won, you know, won big prizes. But usually they do a short story after they come out with their other stuff. Now there's some notable exceptions where somebody just comes in on the scene and with a short story collection wins a Pulitzer. That's great. But you know, as a poet, as a short story writer, you have to look at the little magazines and presses. And you know, when I was for 17 years and I wrote short stories, not a novel, that's where my work was. Mm-hmm. Short stories. It was, and I edited stuff. So I was editing short stories and sending them out. And I could see it from both sides. There's plenty of those magazines out there. Mm-hmm. And as Sonya said, you know, the online is becoming much more respectable. I think you're right. And one thing, in all my time doing short stories, I ran into one person. I went out to see Elle Davis when we were out in a bar, and she comes up, she heard my name, she said, "You Mike White, did you have a story in Nebraska Review?" And I said, "Yeah, it was the only time ever in any literary magazine somebody came up, okay? But if you get it online, you have the chances of thousands of people reading this stuff." So that's a good thing.
I mean, there are plenty of terrific short story collections, poetry collections that come out every year from a lot of good presses. Do not be dissuaded by Mark Gottlieb.
There you go.
He knows that one area, okay?
Correct.
And
correct.
I'm not sure he quite knows that area, but we had him up.
Questions? Questions? Okay, everybody's tired, I think, right?
Yes, Anne?
Even if you're an editor and publisher put you on a book tour, that doesn't mean that the bookstore will be cooperative. My friend Greg Steven was promoting his book in Houston when I lived there. Mm-hmm. And I heard the interview on the radio. I knew where the bookstore was. I went and I couldn't find him anywhere. And I found him on the back of the second floor in a place pretty much equivalent to where we had our reading at the Fairfield bookstore. Mm-hmm. And I got the manager of the store to put up a table by the door. And I waylaid people. And I said, "Hey, did you hear Greg Stevens interview today on the radio?" And they said, "Yeah." I said, "There he is, that's the book." And we sold 10 in an hour.
So, Anne, you have a new job as a publisher. This could be your new role.
But you need some pushy person to do that for you.
You do. And it could be you, it could be somebody else. You know, spouses are good for that.
You remember when Poets and Writers, it used to be called CODA?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
CODA had it had a three people on the cover, maybe 20 years ago, and Terry McMillan, the African American novelist, was on the cover, and two other female writers who had novels published by small presses, and she had her novel published by a large press, and they gave ideas on how a writer has to market his work, and I remember taking notes, and a few years later I had need for doing all of those things, and for instance, you know, when you go to a bookstore, everybody loves to go to a bookstore. You go to a bookstore, but if the press or you don't do your pre-work, homework, before you go to that bookstore, you go there and three people will be there, okay? Right. I remember I did dozens, probably 100 Barnes & Nobles for several books. Mm-hmm. And you go to these bookstores and they put you in the back. At one time it was pouring rain down New Haven and they put me way in the back. and no one came except for this little kid. And he kept talking to me. This is a true story. Talking. Picked up my book, looked at it. He says, "You wrote this?" And he's going like this. He's turning it around. And then the little shit didn't even buy it. You know? I spent 20 minutes talking to him and he didn't buy it. So what I found is that if you're going to go to a bookstore, and the company, whether it's small or medium or big, don't do the homework first, which means getting on radio, getting a newspaper, getting on TV, you're going to go there and you're not going to get many. Okay, so what you have to do is call up. Okay, and I did this a lot. Call up out of the blue and say, "I'm going to be in Charlotte, and I'm going to be in Raleigh." One of my books, they sent me to a bunch of places. I called up and I said, "I'm going to be here. Can I be on your talk show?" And I had a lot of chutzpah, and so I got on TV shows and radio shows, and then at the end they'll say, "Where are you going to be?" I'm like, "You're going to be at the Charlotte Barnes and Noble." And then you get 50 people instead of three, and some of them are not little kids.
Get used to the fact that you're going to have to market your work. You're going to have to do it, no matter who publishes it.
Yeah, yeah.
Doesn't your agent do that for you?
No.
Oh, hell no.
Not at all.
No. Agent sells your book. Editor puts it together, and they have a marketing promotional thing, okay? I had a guy who was from St. Martin's, I think, and it was for my fourth novel, and he was a young kid. And he calls me and he says, "Hey, I just lined up a bookstore for you." And I was living in Wilbraham, Mass., Western Mass. At the time. And he said, "I got a bookstore for you." And he said, "It's in East Longmeadow." I said, "East Longmeadow?" He said, "Yeah, it's just one town over from you." I said, "Yeah, I know where it is. There's no bookstores in East Longmeadow." "No, there's a bookstore here." And so I'm talking to him, and as I'm talking to him, I get my phone book. This is phone book time, a couple, many years ago. And I'm looking through, and I said, "Oh, jeez." I said, "This is a pornographic bookstore." Okay, this dummy got on the phone and just looked up bookstores and lined it up. And I don't know what the people on the other end were thinking. It wasn't 50 Shades of Grey, you know? I mean, really.
Did you go?
I didn't go. I said, "Come on." He didn't know, you know, so.
What book was it?
Garden of Martyrs. Yeah. It was going to be this depressing book with no sex. Now, in your book, we could. Any other questions? Any other questions you guys have? Publishing? I just think, you know Bill's comments were great, and the stuff he passed out, and Sonya's great too. And I just think that what we're all saying is learn the field. Learn the business side of things. We try to do this by having the publishing, editing, and agent panels. We try to do it in our workshops and talks like this panel. You know, even if you say, "I'm not there yet," you certainly don't want to put the cart before the horse and be worried about where you're going to send it before the damn book is good and done. Okay, whether it be poetry or short stories or novel or whatever, but you should start now learning what's out there.
And I think, so one piece of advice I heard a long time ago is that if you have authors who you love, look at the complete list of every place they've published and then just try and follow in their footsteps, right? From the little magazines in their first career, just follow along after them, and that'll give you some path to follow.
And if you want to learn, go ahead.
Short story writers and poets, look at, like Best American Short Stories, Editor's Choice, Pushcart, look in the back, and they'll have the places where these things were published. If you like that poem, you like that story, that essay, you can send out to those places.
Yeah.
And if you want to learn about the industry, go and subscribe to Shelf Awareness and Publisher's Lunch. They're both online, they're both free, and they're daily. Shelf Awareness will send you 2 emails a day, and you learn a huge amount.
What's the second one?
Publisher's Lunch, which is really about deals.
Oh.
And I tend to delete that constantly because it's just not interesting to me most of the time. But Shelf Awareness is really good. Yeah.
.com.
Shelfawareness.com. Yep, they're both excellent. And everybody in the industry uses both of them.
The publishing, editing, and panels like this is not made to depress anybody. And I mean that sincerely. It's made to make you aware. And as much of the bad news as we've given you, that's important for you to know. There's a lot of good news out there in terms of online stuff and places to send and how you can increase your chances of getting something published. Again, if you have a story and it's a thematic issue and they're looking for something, I send out to you guys probably 3 to 5 to 8 a week places they're looking for stories, mm-hmm. and poems and essays and articles, okay? So when you get that stuff and you say, geez, I just finished a poem in my with my workshop and they thought it was really good, and I will send it. Think if it's a thematic issue. Peter?
I just want to say that in the period after, before my first book was published, I'd sold it, but I was living in Marin County, Northern California, and there's one of America's most aggressive and best independent bookstores there in Corte Madera, Marin County, called Book Passage. I don't know if any of you guys have heard. They had authors come in, and so anyway, I went to work in that bookstore for about 3 or 4 months before my book was published. I learned an enormous amount. Elaine Petricelli, who owns the store, was the woman who started Book Sense, which is now
big indie review thing.
But I learned a lot just by sort of being a bookseller. Mm-hmm. I wasn't much of a bookseller, but I saw the books come in, I saw how they were unpacked, I saw how Elaine and the staff treated the books, I saw how they geared up for writers who came, writer events and appearances and readings and stuff like that. And it was invaluable. I can't say a single sort of particularly salient thing that I learned at that time, but I got a real sense of how independent booksellers hand sell and market and appreciate books and what they thought of. You know, I heard them talk about the big publishers, the small presses and stuff like that. So working in a bookstore for however long it was very valuable for me. And then I subsequently went on a book tour, and that really helped me connect with people in bookstores who do, you know, stay loyal to an author and hand sell bookstores. One of the best stores I was in was R.J. Julia, which any of you around Connecticut know.
I think it's great that you brought that up. This is about having a life, not just publishing a book.
Yeah.
And there are lots of aspects to that. You know, I mean, self-publishing, you can start a press. You can get two or three friends and start a press. That's how Alice James' book started in Cambridge. Now it was a feminist press for a long time, but now it's just a collaborative press. You know, back in the 60s and 70s, it was happening all the time, and it started to happen again, you know? You can have fun doing that. You can make money doing that. Maybe not a lot of money, but you may be able to pay the bills, and you have, you know, you make literature your life. Mm. That's the important thing.
Mm. Well said. You think that's it?
Yeah.
Well, I want to thank you guys.